amending the rules and regulations for the distribution of water for the Amatella Eastern Water Agency by amending section 12, effective April 15, 2015. I will now call the hearing order at 6:32. My fault. The purpose of the hearing is for the agency to consider adoption of a resolution amending the agency's rules and regulations for the distribution of water by adopting the 2015 water banking rate. And now I will open the floor up for statements by staff. Dan?
Here, but we're not going to have any extra water, so I directly want to.
Thank you, Dan. I'll comment. Committee members have any comments or staff also, but the committee had had met and discussed the banking rates for some time. With previous years, we've had special banking rate committee. The recommendation was made by the committee members and discussed, and that it seemed to be appropriate. This year, number one main reason, but we're going to have no water in the bank. But notwithstanding the lack of water in the bank, committee felt in future years, when we do have water in the bank, it would be better for AVAC, the bank, to pay for the bank water. And AVAC does have the funds at this time. And when it's withdrawn in later years, that would be at the ongoing rate that would be set at that time. But I try to set a rate and have individual agencies. There was a little bit more of a confusion, and it seemed to be very practical and very simplified. And staff agreed with the concept that it would be just more efficient when there is water to be back, that the agency would pay for it. And when it's withdrawn, it would be at the ongoing rate. So the committee is recommending that no price be established in 2015, and the water investment bank. And we're going to review the issue again in 2016, and I'll give the committee and the staff and the board a little bit more time to consider the idea of agency purchasing potable water, maybe available over the upcoming years. And so, I don't know if any of the committee members would like to speak on that, or their staff would like to discuss it. That's anything additional?
So it has been recharged in previous years.
The recommendation going forward that we bank water not have a bank cover.
Not in a bank that we'd have to set up a rate for drawing water. But not banking it. So that's the recommendation at this time. I don't think we're asking for a vote on the issue. That's something we have a little bit more time to discuss, as we really have more to make for this year, so we have more time to discuss it and just refine it. But
yeah,
I'm not sure if there would be, Mike, in that case, this hearing, we have a board order, so would there need to be a motion on that, or would it be just lack of a motion that we need to do?
I think what you have currently in place is the rate for banked water. And so if you're not going to make banked water available, and you're not going to impose rate, I think it would be appropriate to adopt a resolution saying that. So that, and I think that's what's proposed for a period of time.
So can I make a comment before George's comment and what Rob said? We have two types of water in that bank right now. There's one where there's a small amount left, where actual Foothill and District 40 actually bought the water. And we have an additional of 30,000 of our own water.
About 20.
20,000 of our own water, which I know the rest of the board knew that would be available, that whatever we decided to sell it.
And if the District 40 use all the water, they lose all the water.
So they're done, and Quartz Hill?
Quartz Hill has all theirs in about 3 days.
Okay, and that's only two, right?
Well, there's, yeah, there's a few other small ones that, you know, add up to less than 500.
Oh, yeah, okay. In the future, and that we set the price accordingly per year, as part of our normal farm rates. It'll be less confusing having everybody coming in here. I got 500 feet a year, 10 feet a year, whatever, just different. That's our job. We're elected to be managers of this base in this area now with the things that are going on. So I think we need to think about that in the future when we do go through our planning. That I think that should go off and as much more as we can to put in the ground. And if people need to come to us and need help, then we sell to them accordingly to the cost of selling the water. That's what I'm saying.
Yep, that's a good one. I agree with you. Any more statements for the board?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
After the hearing's closed.
Oh.
And now, are there any statements by any members of the public in the audience regarding this resolution? Okay. I will call the hearing closed at 6:40. And now, Rob, would you like to make a motion?
So is this going to be to adopt resolution number R-1503?
Yes, presented.
I'll second.
So we have a motion, second. Any more discussion? All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Dan, you want to?
Yeah, I'd like to. In your package, there's a presentation that Mr. Means will go through. We've asked him to come and make a kind of an overview tonight. He has a lot of experience. Well, in fact, I think he has kind of his experience on one of the slides. Had a lot of experience in this area. Worked for Metropolitan for quite a while, and then he's been consulting since then. But it's to try to get us a little more focused on our strategic planning. So I think I'll just turn it over to Ed and let him go through his presentation.
Thank you, Dan. Mr. President, members of the board, good evening, and thank you for giving me some time on your calendar here, agenda, to speak to strategic planning. I've been in the water business since 1978, the years that is, and I can't really think of a more interesting time in the business, especially with what's unfolding with the State Water Project. Strategic planning, what I found over my experience, and I'll go through that here just in a little bit, oftentimes comes down to kind of three kind of major primary drivers, and it's the quantity, quality, and customer experience. An anecdote, when I started in 1978, I was trained as a microbiologist, and I was working at UC Irvine for a professor who was doing a project with the Metropolitan Water District, looking at regrowth of bacteria in the dead ends of water distribution systems. And one of the tasks that I had was to collect these water samples. Because it was the poor quality in the system, I didn't really want to go to the residents' houses and say, can I sample your tap because your quality is poor than others. So we sampled out of fire hydrants. And two things happened when we opened fire hydrants. The first is it's incredibly visual, and it's rusty red water because it's sat in the barrel there in the casing. And the second thing is kids from blocks around come to the scene because it's so remarkably visual. And so this particular day, we had opened the hydrant, my partner and I, and true to form, rusty red water shot across the street, and a gang of kids came running up. And there was these two boys, 1 6 and 1 4 brothers, who were about 4 inches away from us sampling this and just wide-eyed. And my partner had grabbed the water bottle and held it up in the air, rusty red water, and he said to the four-year-old, how'd you like to swim in this? And the four-year-old, without skipping a beat, said, gee, mister, I don't think I can fit in. And I like to tell that anecdote because it does really capture the quantity, which is what he was interested in, the quality, which is what we were interested in. And if he had been an actual customer, we completely missed the communication on it. So as we think about strategic planning, it goes far beyond those kind of three fundamental things. You've recently been wrestling with what you want to be in the future with regard to water banking, for example. Some very big and strategic policy questions, a lot of implications, a lot of potential benefits for the community, a lot of cost, and we need to understand those risks. strategic planning helps understand and define the processes, at least to understand those risks. So what I want to do in the course of the next 15 minutes is go through, talk a little bit about why we conduct strategic planning, why organizations do, what processes they typically use, what are those roles of participants and obligations of participants in the process, and then just a little bit on cost and schedule to kind of give you a sense of, you know, is this the red box or a school bus, and how and whether it fits where you are today as an organization, you know, moving into the future. About 5 years ago, I started consulting on my own because I enjoy the flexibility. And over that journey, in the last 16 years of consulting, I've had an opportunity to work with a lot of water utilities nationally and internationally, including some of the biggest ones, including East Bay Mud, Denver Water, Marin Municipal, Madison, Wisconsin, even some small ones, Central Elmore Water and Sewer Authority, but now north of Montgomery, Alabama. So in the process, also worked with several nonprofits and with some private companies and helped with strategic planning. And the process that I'll go here through here shortly is a framework. And that framework is the framework that can apply to whether you're a public agency, a private entity, whether you're a water wholesaler or a water retailer. You'll see as we go through it, that structure is definitely fits the water utility business, in particular the wholesale business quite well. I'm currently working with several utilities, Marin Municipal Water District in Northern California, with Fairfax, Virginia, about a million person utility, and just outside of D.C., Rancho California Water District, Central Basin Municipal Water District. So I have had an opportunity over the years to kind of see all of the elements of both retail and wholesale water operations, and I can bring that to your discussion. There are some unique issues associated with water utilities. It's a natural monopoly. It makes no sense to have duplicative or competitive services in it. So while you don't have a competitive threat facing you, someone selling a product and competing with your product, you do have that need for a public agency that you need to show a direction, a focus, and a set of outcomes that you're committed to and promising to the community. Your appointed elected board gives you that fiduciary responsibility to make sure that you chart a course that's proper for the organization and represent the interests of those rate payers. And of course, it's not just the rate payers. There's a lot of stakeholders in the public water business, including the people who pay the bill, the development community, your staff, other elected officials, the legislature, and the like. So there are a lot of potential players that could touch a strategic plan depending on your interests. So again, very complex time for water utilities. So why do it? Utilities that have undertaken strategic planning, typically, and I'll break it into kind of two categories, those that have done it before and are kind of touching it up, repeating and then reviewing it. Again, it's a journey often and not necessarily a destination, and so you typically review these things every 5 years or so, if not annually through the budget process. But it's an opportunity really for you as a board with staff input, to really sit down and talk about the things that matter most to you as a board, that you want staff to achieve. Setting the goals of the agency, recognizing that those goals, achieve a mission, defining that mission, and defining a vision where you want to be in the future. Now, you've been a very successful agency for years and years. I mean, there's no doubt about that. You're in a very enviable position compared to a lot of your peers. But not having a dedicated and articulated strategic plan, I think, does leave you open to some criticism about whether collectively as a board are giving a strong, uniform vision and view to staff for goals to be achieved on behalf of the agency. So a lot of times what I find is that once you have that plan, and it'll echo the things that you're doing, and it may have some new items that are included in there, but it's a roadmap that you can use to convey to your stakeholders about here's where we're going, here's the unified view of the board, here's the direction to the general manager, the things that we need and want and insist that you accomplish, and it's an opportunity for you to have in writing something that you can hold the general manager ultimately accountable for. And if it's not written down, it's hard to say I'm accountable for it. And then let your general manager, representing the management team, to call the plays, put the ball across the board, and then hold it accountable if he does do that. If doesn't have enough resources, get new resources. If it's too slow, find out why, speed up the process. So your role in it would be participating in workshops. We'll talk more about process, defining those goals. Once you set goals, you set strategies and objectives. Those only happen if there's resources available to achieve them. So you link the plan into your budget process. If you're not making the progress that you want to make, you put more resources in it, or you change the direction. But it's a conscious and collective decision in that sense. And of course, and most importantly, these are living documents. Today we can sit and think about the half dozen big things that are facing us as an agency or in the water business in general, and those change over time. I mean, who would have thought 2 years ago that we would be in the hydrology that we're in today? It's really impressive. Right? So these documents have to be living, they have to be flexible, they have to be reviewed periodically and fresh. So what I want to do is just kind of give you the strategic plan sort of elements that usually start with a vision, which is essentially where you want to be in the future. I like to frame these in the sense of kind of supporting the quality of life in the area. I mean, if you think of all the little things you do and all the medium-sized things you do and all the big things you accomplish, it's really to an ultimate effect. And then what is that? That is to have a vibrant economy that supports a high quality of life for the citizens. So it's a very aspirational kind of thing, supported by a mission. And the mission is really kind of the quantity, quality, you know, cost effective, those kinds of things that support that vision, the purpose of the organization. And then there's a set of goals. And the goals support the mission. If you accomplish the goals, you achieve the mission. You accomplish the mission, you reach the vision. So they're all supportive. Those goals, you know, I just hearing you talking about the water bank and how important that water bank is. One of your goals would probably be framed around establishing a bank that leverages this valuable asset on behalf of the community. So it's as assertive and aggressive as it needs to be to provide not only local supply, but also, again, leveraging that asset. And there may be other goals related to reliability, related to quality, related sometimes to the environment, stewardship, financial integrity. These are goals that you as a board would frame and go. All right, the goals then are supported by a series of strategies. I'll give you an example here in a second, but these are essentially approaches required to achieve the goals. And then under those strategies are objectives. And these objectives are measurable. That's kind of where the rubber hits the road. It's the accountability part. So here are the specific objectives. If I accomplish those, I fulfill the strategy. Fulfill the strategies, which accomplishes the goals, which accomplishes the mission, which accomplishes the vision. So if you think about and then of course below objectives, there's a bunch of, and they call them different things, but tactics, action items, generally key performance measures or key performance indicators can be built in to kind of track progress on these things. It's almost the to-do list at a management level. So what I typically like to do when I do strategic plans is to have the board really own that top half. It's setting the tone and direction for the organization, and then giving management and the staff the responsibility to fill in the strategies and objectives and key performance indicators, and then giving you that apple to comment on. There's a long history of being pro, and what is characterized by a set of very unclear values in the organization. So when you talk about having this dialogue, It's the things that are important that you share, that you insist that you as directors embody, that you insist that staff embody. They typically are things like, you know, integrity and ethics. It could be transparency, could be accountability, could be innovation, could be those kinds of things. But they're personal, they're owned by the board and the management team, and sort of set the tone for how you're going to behave as an organization. Now, you guys have a wonderful history of excellence, and you have great assets, and you know, you've gone without articulating these kinds of values, you embody. I mean, this is how you operate. Sometimes it's good to just have that discussion, emphasize those things, and ensure that we all hold ourselves accountable to those, both at the staff level and at the board level. So values are an important component in the plan. So just to kind of a couple goals, and these are examples of ones that have come out of other plans for reliability. For example, at Agency X, we partner with retailers and wholesalers to provide a level of regional water reliability that ensures customers' water needs are met. This was an agency, a wholesaler actually, that really front and center for their activities were partnerships with their agencies. They couldn't really do anything without that strong support. Important to highlight that. One on financial integrity, managing financial resources in a responsible, effective, and transparent fashion. Again, this was an agency that had some issues there. So when we put it kind of into that sort of real, kind of a real example here, if my personal vision is in yellow here, it's a comfortable and happy retirement. If that's my personal vision, my mission is going to be comprised of three things. I want to have good physical health, I want to have financial freedom, and I want to have good mental health. So those are three of my important goals. There's a set of strategies. If I just look at financial freedom, I'm going to diversify investments as one of my strategies. I'm going to own a nice home. I'm going to try to leave something for the kids. And then under that, I may have a series of objectives. If it's owning a nice home, I'm going to make a decision whether to own or to rent. I may refinance to 15 years. I may downsize. And objectives, like I said earlier, are importantly are characterized by the fact that they're very measurable. You can check the box whether you achieve them or not. And that's oftentimes when you do scorecards on these plans, you focus on those objectives. When you look at everything, the objectives are gaining traction on those measurable things, that if you do all those, you'll achieve the strategies, achieve the mission, achieve the vision. And then below that, oftentimes, I've done this with utilities, but I think oftentimes those, you assign those to management, but it's the tactical level, it's the to-do list almost. For example, if I were going to refinance for 15 years, I'd have a set of tactics. I'd have to make an appointment with a mortgage broker. I'd have to look at my finances, can I really make that down payment? I mean, those are getting into some of the details, and generally speaking, I think that's best left to management to sort those specifics out, certainly not the board. What you're interested in is that goal of financial freedom for the agency, for example, is met, right? And you're going to keep track of the details. Obviously, you're going to be responsible for the fiduciary issues along the way. So a lot of times people ask the question, well, if we have all these plans, we have a strategic plan, and we have a capital improvement plan, a finance plan, we have master plans, we have an asset management plan, we may have an integrated resources plan. How do those things all sort of, are they duplicative? And the answer is not at all. They're all supportive. And the strategic plan captures all of those elements. And this is just a schematic of how these sort of support each other. The strategic plan embodies a series of goals shown in the purple to the right. And then these other plans beneath it support that strategy. So the goals themselves find their way into your communications plan. So for example, when you just have taken an action about a water bank or funding or rate sort of issue, when you do the press release, if that calls for a press release, you always try to tie that action back to one of the goals you made. So you think of your goals as the commitments, your promises. They're, in fact, in my view, they're your brand. They're the things that you're promising to the community. So you take credit for actions that support that brand. And over time, when you do this consistently, people find value in what you do because you're selling the value proposition of each one of your actions. We promise you water reliability. We built the bank. We delivered the bank. So you take credit in the plan and allow you to do that if it's tied tightly with your communication strategy. So a typical process on the left-hand side is data collection. And this can involve staff workshops, it can involve white papers, essentially there's interviews involved, typically with individuals, directors, and staff members identifying the key issues. It may involve looking external to the organization about kind of macroeconomic issues or other larger scale, bigger picture issues, say water reliability, AB 32, energy costs, could be other regulatory drivers, could be technology innovations that will improve pump efficiency, things like that. oftentimes is sort of the environmental scan part of strategic planning is important. It helps you sort of see the big picture in the world of things going on around you. That data collection then is brought into a board workshop where we really try to focus you on the vision, mission, values, and goals, and get the board to settle on those high-level elements of the plan. Then the board hands that to management and says, okay, here's the goalpost, here's what we said we wanted to get. You guys come up with the strategies and objectives, and then we'll, you know, look over your shoulder a little bit on it, but we're going to let you guys know what plays. So the draft plan is then prepared, brought back for a collective review. Once that is settled, then you prepare a scorecard off of that. Often some agencies don't do that. Some just prepare the scorecard just to kind of keep track. Others take it all the way to the point of linking it to compensation, you know, where the performance against the scorecard actually really counts. You know, I don't advise, if you're new to that, this kind of process, going that far at this stage. I think, you know, steps are appropriate and getting, you know, accustomed to that process, and then later on, if you want to link that to actual general manager's evaluation, you can do that. But that's the board call. And then we tee it up for board approval. A number of things, we don't have time tonight, but perhaps in the future we can go through them. But a couple supporting tools that are often used these days. SWOT analysis, this is strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. That is a tool that's been around for many, many decades, and it's essentially a kind of either a survey or an interview or a workshop kind of tool where you literally have the group talk about strengths. What are the things that help an organization move forward? What are those weaknesses? If you corrected them, would you do better? What opportunities? And what threats? The second one that I'll just mention is that's gaining a fair amount of traction now. The large water and wastewater agencies a few years back got together and came up with what they call this effective utility management structure. And EUM consists of kind of 10 attributes of effectively managed utilities, and they do survey kind of work, questionnaire work against those attributes, so essentially asking how are you performing in that area and how important it is to your future as an organization. So you do it with the board, you do it with staff, and the beauty of EUM, and it's got some of the foibles in my view, but one of the beauties of it is if there's any disconnect between either management and rank and file staff or management and board about how things are going, EUM shines a bright spotlight on that. Maybe you could have a dialogue about, well, how come we're perceiving that this is going real well, and management goes, oh, well, we could do better. It just really generates a nice dialogue. So just a couple graphics. The SWOT analysis components, it's very common sense and straightforward and helpful. And then effective utility management. And these are the 10 attributes. So you essentially delve into how well you're doing on resource adequacy, water resource sustainability, operational optimization, etc. And you go through these systematically, and there are survey tools that you can use for it. Yeah, it's actually, I've done it in a couple cases, and I think it's helpful. And then one important thing, as you contemplate strategic planning, is how are you gonna, you know, how broad of an effort is this? You know, how much external input is appropriate or sensible, you know, or wise, or important to do? And, you know, we have a range of engagement or involvement levels that we can bring people in, from simply, you know, closing all the doors and sitting down and figuring out what it is and then telling people what it is, right? And that's kind of the least engagement, up to, you know, the far end of this graphic here where we're going to tell the community, well, you tell us what to do. And obviously, neither of those is the appropriate for you, but that's an important thing for you to think about as you contemplate this, is, you know, is the involvement with members of the business community, or the environmental community, or the agricultural community, the development community, is it, you know, are there important legislators to talk to in this, or are there, or not? So you just think about that, because generally the more folks you involve, this is the higher the budget. So you have to think what works for you as an agency. All right. Then one of the other drivers in the cost of these plans is if you have to do a lot of basic kind of research, some like Fortune 500 companies will go out and commission a series of white papers about macroeconomic conditions in China for selling products, you know, into China or manufacturing in China, or, you know, is Vietnam a better place to, you know, to manufacture? And they'll do a lot of fundamental, you know, on the ground research. I haven't found that to be the case, or that, frankly, that critical in water, with a couple exceptions. And one is you're contemplating groundwater banking and expansion and development of that. A market analysis in there of, you know, how big is too big in terms of market players and what people are willing to contribute, what kind of phasing is important. Those might be fundamental kinds of questions you want to have answered in some basic assessment of research or white paper. And then the third kind of big driver I found for strategic plans is the, and I mentioned it earlier, it's just the production values that you have. Orange County Water District did a strategic plan that's really quite gorgeous, beautifully graphically laid out, and I think the production costs on the document itself are something like $50,000. I mean, just for beautiful magazine quality. I don't think personally that's a wise strategy. I think it just waves a flag that we're more interested in something. I personally think it's a beautiful plan, but I found that they can be just equally effective if they're just relatively plain. It's the words that matter, you know, and a few pictures, but it doesn't have to be anything. And again, that's a price cost driver for you. So as I have thought about your situation here today, is, you know, from my viewpoint and what I know is that task-wise, you've got something on the order of, you know, conducting the SWOT analysis, the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats, meeting with the management team, sitting down with each of you board members, talking about your priorities, probably doing the EUM survey. It's relatively small, 40-some employees, and then board members, and then any other parties that you think might be appropriate. Having a kickoff workshop out of that, homing in on the mission, vision, values, and goals, get that locked in. Draft the plan, sit down with management to go through the strategies and objectives, float those as straw proposals to the board, come back, give you a bite of the apple, do whatever iterations necessary, adopt the plan, and then if you wish, develop a scorecard, which is, in this case, a fairly simple Excel spreadsheet that captures goal strategies and objectives with accountabilities, and identifying resource needs, that kind of thing. And my sense is, and this is a real loosey-goosey, but I think if you did all of these, you could do it for less than $60K in a 4 to 6 month period. Now, I've seen strategic plans range anywhere on the low end of them from about $15,000 up to the top end, well over $500,000. I met when they did, I was involved in theirs in 96, it was $480,000, and that didn't include a lot of internalized costs. They had very large public forums and the like that drive the costs of those kinds of efforts. So I don't think that's anywhere near appropriate for your situation. So
and that for you? So every 5 years we have to do the integrated water management plan, so it is every 5 years?
Right.
So my creating this schematic of the agency, this would then tie into the integrated management plan, would flow right into that, wouldn't it?
Right.
Urban water management, so, and then, you know, periodically, whatever, the consultant comes back, and they look at this thing, you know, 4.5 years, whatever, and they're ready for the next 5 years.
I think it really, it does fit in with a lot of other efforts. I mean, grant funding, bond ratings, you know, integrated regional water management plans, they all dovetail into these things. You'll see a lot of interplay between them. And you'll find that a lot of these things you've probably addressed or thought about, and that's why, you know, AVEC has been successful, because we've done a lot of other things. It's just that it hasn't been a big collective job.
Well, and also when it comes to financing, we're working with the banks on, you know, revenue bonds and things like that. they're going to be looking for these types of material to weigh in wherever you rank, even with maybe a bond rating, we can go up to and get a, increase our bond rating because we have such a plan showing where the money is being borrowed, but also where it's going to be paid back through this, this type of plan. I'm asking, that's a question.
That's, you're correct.
Okay.
Yeah, in fact, I think that's, in fact, when we've gone to bond, you know, rating agencies, we've shown them the essence of a plan. You know, so this is how we're going to pay for it, this is how we're funding it, this is what our rates are doing, this is what our coverage ratio is. So a lot of the components of a plan were presented when we talked to bond rating agencies last time. And they like to see that. They like to see the board of directors thinking kind of down the road and how you're approaching it.
You know, it's interesting your presentation because we do, a lot of us go to different conferences and spend a lot of time, you know, getting educated in the changes that take place, but I've noticed in the papers throughout Northern California, Southern California, the one that doesn't have, well, I mean, we all have issues and have to watch ourselves, but Orange County seems like they have like the best master plan of organization for water. Like we're talking about gray water, reclaimed water, they're like so far more advanced. When I go to these different conferences, everybody laughs, says, we don't need to have these plans, and who, you know, who cares about sewer water, this and that. I saw so many things like they have gutter runoffs in these tanks where they're taking plastic tanks and watering their plants. I don't hear from anywhere else in the state of California except that county. I just thought that was pretty interesting.
They're very progressive in that regard, you know. I mean, you know, the Santa Ana River has been recycled water since, you know, since San Bernardino started developing in Riverside. So there's a long history of reuse there. And of course, they took it over the top and went to the groundwater replenishment system. And they're expanding.
And I realized, you know, all these lakes we hear down there, because I happen to like to fish, is that all those lakes are holding ponds for water treatment facilities.
Right, San Diego, Anaheim Lakes, right.
Yeah,
yeah.
The Glendale Lake, you know, all those different lakes down there.
Right.
It's amazing.
Right, yeah, well, and you know, and that's kind of one of these strategic areas that, you know, it's not really very hard to imagine the state, you know, coming in like they have done in Florida and Australia, is they're really clamping down on wastewater discharges to the ocean, just saying, hey, you know, you have to be able to use.
Can we tell the governor regarding the fish that we can do the same thing?
Regarding the fish?
Yeah, this is not wastewater, this is drinking water.
It's drinking water. Yeah, well, it's definitely, I'm actually currently working with the director down at the city of San Diego, and they're have an 83 MGD indirect potable reuse project on tap, a couple $1 billion worth of capital investment that they're trying to fast track. And now they're actually even trying to take it to direct potable reuse. So indirect, you put it either in the ground, pump it up, or you put it in a reservoir if it's a reservoir augmentation. But now they're looking at direct, putting it in pipelines direct to people. So the temperature's rising.
Well, the Yellow Valley has all these things in play right now. County, you know, waste management, water management, things like that. The question is going to be for this agency, and also with the real water adjudication, groundwater adjudicated, groundwater basin as well, is how do we sell this to the public to integrate all this stuff into one system so we can, it's going to cost more, that's all there's going to be. And that's something we're going to need a lot of help.
Right. Well, see, and that's why, that's one of those things where a plan, when you write it down, it is a roadmap. And people can agree or disagree with the roadmap, but at least they can see the roadmap. And it's not that you aren't doing these things. It's just you are. And you, I mean, obviously you've been very successful historically. But once you put it down in writing, it can be used as a calling card. It can be converted into the elevator speech. If someone wants the backup, here it is. You know, and it embodies, again, all the good things you've been doing. And through the dialogue, maybe you have some aha moments about some things that you really need to double down on in order to get where you need to get. And then you, as a board, you can decide, here, we want to emphasize this, we want to put some more resources into getting this done, or tell Dan and the management team, you know, priority number one. But it's there, it's articulated, it's written down, and you can use it as a not only for the financial community, but for any stakeholders. The organization I'm working with that's got the issues, they're the subject of a state audit. The state auditors are in there now doing a $350,000 audit going through everything. you know, and one of the first things that they're, you know, going to land on is not having a strategic plan, and which is one of the reasons why they're moving aggressively to get that proposal. And I'm not inferring that that's an issue at all. All I'm saying is that that's something that, it's just a good thing to have. You're relatively, MET was 51 members when we did it before, so you can imagine that has to be committee. But we also found out it ended up being committees of the whole because it was so important. You know, so I think in your case, I would do it as the whole board. But I'll add the caveat that you know your dynamic and you know the issues that you agree and disagree on. And, you know, and I don't know those. So if you think that your committee structure has been effective in that regard, so you know when recommendations come from the committee, by and large, the board, you know, delegates to that committee that responsibility. And yeah, you review it and get comfortable, but you know, I don't want to use a trust word, but you know, you let the committee do its thing, right? If that works, if the committee thing works for you, then consider committees. The one I'm involved in Fairfax County, it's a 9-member board. They have a strategic planning committee, but the board has devolved or evolved, depending on your perspective, into committees of the whole. So they have full committee structure, but all board members go, and the committees are before the board meeting. So it's not a very functional kind of setup. And in that case, you may as well just have the whole board do it.
So is it possible that maybe the entire board could start and do your interviews and the staff takes it over and then it goes to the committee?
Certainly.
Like have a committee.
Yes. Well, in fact, in this example, yes. Sure.
He doesn't know our structure. The problem with that, I think your question is very good regarding, I personally believe the whole board, and the reason I believe the whole board is for this, is several of us sit on several committees, the overlap, so there's a possible violation of our rights. Okay, you know, I sit on the real estate committee, I sit on the recharge committee, environmental, committee, I mean, we're all doing multi-committees here. This agency is going to see the biggest change in the history of this valley in the next 5 or 10 years. And things that have nothing to do with AVAC are going to be victims of circumstances to implement a lot of things. And when the groundwater recharge program comes in, and we have groundwater management sites, it's not our own adjudicated area, there's areas in our district that are not in the groundwater adjudicated groundwater basin, that are going to be mandated to have a management program, we're going to have to deal with that. If we, God forbid, we have another 1 more year or 2 more years of drought, that's going to be another issue. And those will overlap other committees. I personally think as a board, we pick, so this thing's done, the extra Tuesday night, you know, when we decide as a board, and make that our strategic plan to get this thing going. By committing, it's great, but a lot of you, the 4 of you who are not going to be on that committee or whatever it's going to be, or myself, we're going to be asking a lot of questions. Do you want to do this in 6 months? Or do we want to do it in 2 years? And that's the thing we have to. I think we need to move fast on this thing. I think we had some committee meetings the other day. It's funny about refinancing. We're going to be bringing a refinance program to you. That's going to save our taxpayers $2.5 million by doing this program here in the next meeting. So everything's here. We just need to bring it all together. And everybody on this board pretty much 90% agrees. But we need to bring it all together. That everybody understands what's going on.
This is through the vision, mission, values, and goals. We've done that. At least, if not the wordsmithing, concepts within each of those, and wordsmithing can go later. At worst, you're talking about a couple of two 4-hour sessions at worst, if we hit the wall, and it's happening, where the boards are divided, and they can't, you know, agree on the concepts, so you need some additional, you know, work.
And we do that, and we're starting at lunch.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Haynes, excellent presentation. Thank you very much. I was wondering if you would have the ability of working with our staff to get us four or five strategic plans that have already been completed by agencies like us.
Yeah,
and
sure.
That might be something that works for
you. Yeah, you can kind of get a feel. Sure, absolutely.
And the other comment is I agree with you. The other comment is I think we would agree very much with the entire board. And next week is this.
And so I have a question for the president. Aaron, I'm going to come back. I've done several strategic plans in the school and all that stuff. Right now we're working on a lot of resource conservation. And I understand evolve to empower, but I really believe when it's going to go to the finance committee to look over his proposal or to send it to another, I don't care on that, but I really think we should have in the proposal that we at least have a workshop for our customers, not necessarily the general public, but at least the mutuals and stuff. I'd love to hear what they think we should do. And that's what happened with the Resource Conservation District. They got a bunch of stakeholders. They went through the mission and vision. That's all they talked about. And then that went back to the board. The board wasn't there at that stakeholders meeting. They could come to the board meeting and make a case. But that information at least got back to the board to say, gee, we don't want you water bank. You know, if that's what we're hearing, then we'll have to make a decision. Or we need to be more in water banking. It'd be kind of neat to hear what our customers say. So I would really love to have a stakeholders component. That wasn't, I think, in here.
No,
you know, you've talked about it, but yeah. I think there needs to be at least one to hear what our customers say we should do.
That's what one agency kind of stuff. So that's easy enough to, you know, to put into this. Again, I didn't want to assume, but where you are on that scale of engagement is a really important question for you to ponder. But it would be very easy to build.
Yeah, I just love to hear the input from them on what they think we should be. Not empower them to say this is.
You know, the thing too you can do is that with the EUM, it doesn't hit the bigger picture issues, but it does give you their view on how you're doing in a bunch of the operating areas. So that's really easy to extend to them. And of course, you could have a workshop on it, as I talked about.
So, our whatever committee is going to look at those proposals, you know, I would like to see some sort of workshop with our purveyors, our customers. But at least of the mission vision, not into the strategies and all that stuff that gives us and something else just for that. Just like we should have our employees and the same stuff.
Process, do agencies normally involve the public or the federal?
Yeah. There's the one in Fairfax, and that's 1,900,000 service people served. They're not involved with the public. All the directors are appointed by board supervisors for the area, for the county, and they, you know, have made a decision. They're a little insulated, if you will, and so they've decided that they're not going to go out and talk to the business, you know, community and the like. I've worked for others, though, that have had interviews with environmental reps. Marin, for example, is very green, environmentally oriented, three or four key environmentalists in that area that appear at all the board meetings and are very active. They have a beautiful watershed, Mount Tamalpais, and they had me interview a couple members of the business community as well that were important stakeholders. A couple, frankly, folks that attended all the meetings that just out of interest, citizens that were engaged. So you can tailor that depending on, you know, who those opinion leaders are that really will influence where you're going. If there are key players that have your fate in their hands, if you will, you can engage those folks. Again, you can do it through interviews up front, a little simple SWOT analysis. Or you know, in the case of, you know, MWD, there were three large forums that were put together with, you know, 200 people each. You know, come one, come all, tell us what you think, kind of thing. But before we do the effective utility management or do the kickoff workshop, do it at that point. So when we come to the kickoff workshop, I can feed to you the information from the interviews with the various folks, including yourselves. I mean, and again, the goal is not to attribute comments or statements to any individual. It's to really capture the sense of the input. And so feed that back to you as a board at that workshop, because that'll help you think about where you need to direct the agency. So again, to be specific, I would do it somewhere between after the individual board interviews and the effective utility management piece, and then bring it to you at the kickoff workshop. Here's what I've heard.
Okay.
Yes, Rob.
Your comment about the public and our customers?
Earlier, Ed had indicated that sometimes agencies choose to involve the public, and we haven't defined the public. But Neil had a suggestion in limiting it perhaps to our customers. Did that happen?
I could say BIA or Senator Gavin or something, anybody who has a overall backward view to it. It's going to be an open meeting if it's a workshop.
The cities.
Yeah. But, I mean, if it's an open workshop here and it's a public agency, you're not going to prevent any public person from coming in to do that. But I was not really considering the average public person.
What you could do is tee up kind of like a focus group. It's not a random focus group, but it's basically you pick 15 or 20 opinion leaders in the community, ranging from developers try to get a cross section of people, both in terms of their economics, ethnicity, truly representing the broad picture, and then just sit down with them. And most of them may not even know about AVEC because they turn on the tap and the water's there. But that would be another way, short of doing a come one, come all kind of thing. You'd want to select those people carefully so you get people that are basically
knowledgeable. Kind of focus with research conservation districts and out letters to the World Health Council. Something like just a certain group, and we met at the Air Quality Control Board and just sat down and did a SWOT on vision and mission.
Yeah.
They had made 12, I think, poster-sized comments, and that was going to go to the board workshop.
And you know what I like to do on those is I try not to, when we talk to stakeholders, try not to, I mean, ultimately you have the responsibility as a board. It's your responsibility to own that top of this plan. So what I like to do with stakeholders like that is I like to run them through the SWOT. But I stop them short of defining mission or vision, because at the end of the day, I don't want to come to you and say, here's what you have to do, kind of thing, because that's your job to do that. And so so just a qualifier on that, but exactly, do the SWOT with them, and frankly, as you do the SWOT, when you talk about the opportunities, all of that stuff comes up. And the way I like to do them is just give people, and you can do this with a lot of folks, even 50, 60, 80 folks, is give them sticky notes and just say, write all the things that you think are strengths about AVEC, and put them on the wall, and then synthesize and talk about it, and do the same for opportunities, weaknesses, and threats. So it's a real quick way to get a big data dump on the wall, facilitate a dialogue, stop short of having them craft. And what you see is, when you go through this, is the strengths pop out, and the weaknesses pop out. In fact, I've done some of this with utilities where it's sort of, it won't be your case, but it's been embarrassing, but all the green sticky notes, which are the strengths, comprise about 10, and all the reds, which are the weaknesses, are like 200, and they're side by side, and it's like, awkward. But no, generally, they're pretty well balanced, and it's a good, quick way to get a lot of data and engage people. Because otherwise, when big groups, people get frustrated because they don't have enough time to talk.
But as far as deciding if we want to do a workshop with our customers, if we want to do a workshop with our focus group, those are things we can discuss now and make recommendations to the committee so that we can come back and give a cost of what it's going to be if we can get consensus tonight on what we want to do.
George, finish the presentation, but it's my understanding, and usually when you get a quota, we haven't talked to this gentleman before, we haven't looked at the contract, and probably does a very good job, but it needs to look at in more detail, needs to be looked at, should be receive alternative bids, and some of the items we're talked about is going to be, probably several of those items we may want to look at in more detail and decide which way to go, but I would think it probably should be looked at by the Finance Committee as far as the financial end of it, and seem to be brought back to the board to talk about what items, I'm talking about the specifics which you're speaking of right now, but I think those were good suggestions, but
it's a process. It needs to be done over a meeting or two. And it's, I want to make sure we've done it right. And I think through the years, the board has made good decisions because we haven't made hasty decisions. And we've saved the agency more than millions of dollars right there. And so it's a certain process and probably
not to answer.
We should continue.
George's question, what stage do we have to have request for proposals? Is there a dollar value or is there any kind of for professional services, you're not required by law to request for proposals?
It was my understanding that tonight, what Ed was going to do is present what a strategic plan is and for the rest of the board to say to commit that they want to do a strategic plan. Not necessarily with Ed, not necessarily for what costs, but just overall the concept that we're all agree that we should have a strategic plan. And then
maybe a schedule of how what steps we have to follow up out as soon as they come back.
I have a question. Nothing on the screen. How do you come about? I mean, is that, was it referred by staff? You went out and looked at. Okay. I just wondered. I mean, your credentials, I mean, I don't have them here, but what you said, absolutely amazing. I mean, I don't know if it gets much deeper than that. I mean, physically working for Matt and physically working with some of these agencies you're working for, I agree with Director Sourceball on this agency needs a plan. We've never, this is the time is perfect to have something like this done. And if this is, the finance committee can look at it, if this is the person, that's fine. But I think we should make a decision here within less than 30 days of what direction we're going to go. That's all I'm saying. Whatever, you know, within 30 days. I want to get this thing done by the end of this year because we got, you know, buildings, we're built on. I personally want to see us buy another 1,000 acres out there of land for the future growth and development. You know, we're going to need help on that. You know, where's the money going to come from? You know, how do we integrate the city of Lancaster and Palmville, rainwater for percolation? You know, these things, we're going to need to do something. And just having committee meetings and doing it and putting one piece of puzzle here and this piece of here, I don't think that's the best interest for everybody. I think we need to have road that we all go down the same. Even if we don't agree to it, at least we have a road we can walk down together and understand. Like you said, we might not like it, but at least we know up front what it's going to be about.
It just, I think most everything you said in general, but try to put the time and 30 days. We have done some contracts in the past. We got down into those contracts and there's some things, or just recently some things we didn't like. And there's, hey, we should look at that a little more detail. And if it's 30 or 45 days, it doesn't make a bit of difference at this point, if it's 60 days, but one look at the contract. And I think of two in particular that we, well, I think of three in particular that we need to look at in more detail right there. And so I just don't want to promulgate that same thing mistakes when we do something in haste. The worst thing we can do is get the contract and people say, that's a standard contract. Everything was talked about the general plan is probably valid and good, but the contract, that's a separate issue.
So how would you suggest that we go about doing this?
Well, I think what you said, it made no sense about more or less going ahead. That could be a goal, but as far as the contract needs to be looked at, and if there's any questions, then we have a chance to review
them. I don't know if there's a motion. I think the president will decide to finance or to ad hoc committee, whatever he wants to do. We've got our opinion for all that we do.
Well, the motion is that we all say, yes, we are buying into this and that we want to have more advisories.
I'll second that.
Can I make a comment? Sure. George, when I said, work on goals, and what goal means is that you're attempt to achieve something. I said 30 days, it takes 45 days or whatever. That's fine too, but you've got to start with something. I didn't say 5 days, I said 30 days.
So we have a formal motion?
Yes.
What
motion is that the board agrees that we want to put a strategic plan in place.
Yeah,
and we're going to do so.
Can
Okay, we have a motion second, any further discussion? By the way, the proposal will be reviewed by the finance team, so I'll ask Chairman to go.
Yeah, you gotta get to go home.
Yeah. All right, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Jump right into water supply, maybe I should skip right through these slides. My allocation's at 20%. The operation studies that they've done recently, they have a series of studies that they run, different hydrologies, different fish requirements and so forth, and they all come pretty close to 20%. They're like 20, 21, 22%, so don't expect any big changes. You know, they had a little bit of rain up there, but nothing big. Oroville is, you can tell, has dropped just a little bit from the last board meeting. San Luis has dropped a little bit from the last board meeting. Here's the reservoir conditions. Oroville 65%, San Luis is 72%. And this is, this is the forestation index. So we're just a little bit above, as far as precipitation, a little above what we were last year. But again, this has all been kind of rain and not snow. This is the snow conditions. That red line near the bottom is 1977, which is kind of the benchmark for super dry years. So we're well below 1977. So essentially no snowpack. So you've got 5% and 6% of average. And April 1st is usually the date when they do the last official snow survey. And that's why the governor had the press releases and so forth. That's the time they usually talk about the snowpack. This is Oroville, so it's kind of flattening out as far as actual storage. Blue line is the actual storage. And the red line is green line. That's the flood control envelope. This is San Luis, and this is really, again, what's kind of saved us this year is we just bumped up about 1 million acre feet for statewide project storage, and that's what our 20% is based on, water we got south of the Delta.
So why was San Luis better this year than it was last year?
It's just an operative, we had a decent December, and we could pump during December, and then it just did, nothing happened in January. And those pumps just kind of kept chugging along. And so we had more opportunity and less fish catches. They had to do some kind of creative things to avoid catching any smelt this year. And they actually were somewhat successful.
I thought it was because we used our water.
Yeah, well, yeah. Part of it. Operations, Quartz Hills at 12 MGD, Roseman East Side, Palmdale connection are all off. The 96th Street East, we have actually started pumping on Tuesday. So that's up and running. WSSP2 is 13, well, this is our west side bank, 15. This is our groundwater production charts. The dark blue is our 14 capability, and the red or maroon or cyan, whatever that is this year's capability. So we're tracking ahead of what we had last year. That red line is kind of what our maximum production will be on our pumping capability. I have some charts I'd like to hand out to directors. I've got hard copies of the case that we carry that much more in the state water project into next year. So we have a little more to carry.
Another 5,000 feet carryover?
If we had the 36,000 in demand, we'd have a little over 5,000 acre feet carried over with our present estimates. If we have 31,000 in demands, then a little over 10,000 carried into next year.
Something tells me that.
3 months and then what they took last year, so that's kind of what we added to 31,000. That actually includes a reduction from last year. It gives you a feeling for sensitivity. And these numbers include, our state water project, the this includes our exchanges. So there's, there would be 15,000 on top of this. Exchanges. Moving along, water banking. As I mentioned earlier, 96th Street East is pumping at 1,300 MGD, or excuse me, gallons per minute. And we are extracting it at East Side Bank. We have, next couple slides I'd like to talk about, Metropolitan District, Water District of Southern California. We've, yes, ma'am. 96th
Street, I'll be included in this.
So we've been having a series of meetings with Metropolitan to kind of talk about banking programs, and I kind of want to summarize for the board what we've been discussing with them. There's two components. One is a storage component where Metropolitan would take 30,000 acre feet and they would store their table A in our service area. And then in some future year, within 10 years, we would return that through a table A exchange. So we wouldn't have to pump it back or anything. We'd return 90% of it, and they pay us $250. So we really don't have to do any operational changes. We just do a table A exchange. And the way we structure this is if it's available, if we can take the water on the storage end, and then when we pay it back, it's strictly table A exchange. There's no pump back. If we went into pump back, then we talk about costs. They would reimburse us for costs. So we're kind of at a conceptual level at this point. But that's the storage component. The exchange component is if AVEC has a year, let's say we have an 80% year next year, or 100% year, AVEC has historically not been able to get all the water we wanted, either we couldn't pay for it or we couldn't get a recharge. They basically said, don't leave any water on the table. If you have water, recharge all you can, exchange all you can, sell all you can. If you have any water left over, then loan it to us, and we will return it within 10 years, and we'll bring it to your turnout free of charge. So basically, it's yeah, it's water that you wouldn't be able to utilize anyway, and they say we'll pay you back and cover your power costs to get to our turnout.
Can you go back to storage and walk me through that?
Sure. So if Metropolitan, let's say we have it, and one of the things Met admitted is that they have a lot of other storage programs going, and they've got a lot of holes to fill. So if we had an 80% year, 60, 80% year, they're probably going to be busy filling a lot of those holes, and they may not have additional water to recharge in AVEC service area.
Now this, you're talking about this year?
Well, I'm talking about, well, for sure this year, but they're even saying next year, if next year was gangbuster year, they're still low in all their reservoirs and all their recharge programs and stuff. So if it happened, that's great. They just didn't want us to be too optimistic, like, oh, great, we're going to get water next year, because it's going to take them a little time to recover. But they anticipate within the next 3-4 years that they would have their table A available to recharge. So we said, well, let's do a reasonable amount, you know, 10, 15. We said, let's do 30,000. So it's kind of a pilot program where if they had 30,000 of their table A allocation, they would deliver it to our turnout. We'd run it out, recharge it in any one of our bases. We could recharge it East Side, West Side, whatever we want to do. And then we would retain 10%, you know, for the basin, and then 90% of it would be a table A exchange. So if we have an allocation in the future, and we can just exchange the table A, you know, we don't have to. Yes.
So
I mean, we haven't, you know, this is conceptual, but
if we had 100% year, we could.
Yeah.
Here's your 30.
We could. I mean, there's probably gonna, the way they were talking in their bullet points, it's like
27,000.
Yeah. I think there's gonna be some, you know, mutual agreement on being able to take it back. I don't know, you're gonna be able to cram it.
Yeah, that would.
Yeah. But within 10 years, we return it, and it's just through table A exchange, so we don't have to do.
And the one area that we at this point we limited capacity of a water plant.
Right.
We,
so
we put that much water on both sides, East Side, West Side.
You talking 30,000?
Mm-hmm. Good question.
there might be better.
Well, I want 85%. I mean, we haven't gone back to me. I'm just throwing this out. You mean percentage retained here, Warren?
We don't know what other deals are out there. We have to explore that for a couple.
That's true.
60, 90, 100.
Well, guess what? Take the 30 right now, and then we get room for 20 more.
But George, you're supposed to say you need to take our time.
My rate. And I agree with you. So.
Jim, well, this room.
I didn't even get 5 days.
Or can we wait to our strategic plan?
My response is that you are not tied in to take their water. I mean, we've structured it to where, hey, if we got another deal, another partner wants to pay us $350 or something.
Look, okay. Whatever,
conceptually, this is great.
Whatever the, yeah, there we go. And the thing is that where we need to see, we should ask for it, it's whatever everybody agrees on, whatever the percent is. But, you know, let's ask and see what happens. That's all I'm saying.
And kind of in your response to, you know, let's get it done. My recommendation is we put an MOU together. They'd like to sign something at Aqua, which is in 2 weeks. And they'd like to have their board president come out to our banks. So they're definitely interested
in something
out.
We're not going to make a 2 week deal.
What can you get seat?
I thought Matt was seat.
They want to get going on things. They want to do a pilot program. They recognize if water was available, let's say if next year is an 80% year, this exchange opportunity may be available. AVAC may be recharging as much as we can. We still may have some water left over. So it's really just building a relationship. It's just putting an MOU together. You know, we have plenty of time to put the meat on the bones because there's no water available right now to work with. So, yeah, my recommendation is we just move forward. Kind of put some principles together and come back to the board.
And it's all kind of relative because 30,000 to them is nothing. It's like, and to us, it's a pretty good chunk.
Well, the other thing is we've been trying so hard to create an issue with Matt because Matt can move things very easily and get politically things through for us that other people couldn't. So what do you need? Do you need anything from us?
You know, if you're comfortable, we'll continue to work on putting some principles together and bring it back to board of directors.
No harm in that.
Never saw George as anxious when you were moved over.
We've
been working on this. It's not new. It's been well over a year.
Yeah, we have been.
Probably been talked about for 2-3 years.
Yeah, we have been talking about this.
So you sure you're slow. We got water in our bank already.
Water quality, again, quality remains good. You know, we're pumping a lot of groundwater. State water project, we have received the second $3.75 million, you know, in the exchange, so that was wired to us. I think board members are all familiar with the executive order. I think it was in the pass around file. I think we have 3 or 4 of our customers on that list of agencies that need to cut back 35%. So it's going to be something that continues to be developed over the summer.
And it's not the state water contract.
They used, there are some of Mike's other customers. Clients are on that list. AVAC is not. I think they went after urban water users. And
mostly retailers.
Yeah.
There are state water contractors that provide water on a retail basis.
Check Palmdale.
Palmdale's
on the list. Yeah, Palmdale's
on the list.
They want to store any water at $500?
And, you know, these contract negotiations to add more flexibility to the contract, those are continuing. They had another session today, so I'll continue to be involved. And then we do have an announcement, and some board members knew about this, American Academy of Environmental Engineers and Scientists. We submitted an application for a project in excellence in environmental engineering and science and received the National Grand Prize Award for environmentally sustainable projects. So Mike and Dr. Ferguson are going to go to Washington, D.C., make a short presentation and receive the national award.
Thank you.
happening April 23rd. Aqua is in Sacramento May 4th through the 8th, and I will be in Sacramento for the rest of this week. But I'll be back in the office. That concludes my report.
On that,
news from the Eastside Bank, our replacement well started surging, doing pumping and surging Saturday, and it's producing 1,850.
Yeah,
excellent. I won't promise it's going to stay there, but it looks good for a 1,200 to 1,300 GPM pumping that well.
Great.
It's good news.
Do you want to do the aqueduct?
That's not a bad idea.
Okay, we are going to revisit a presentation. I've chopped this up pretty good and took out a lot of things Dr. Ferguson did back on February 24th. And what we're looking to do here is move forward on the design of the next five wells out at the Westside Bank. That bank came on roughly a year ago, and it's been pumping constantly since. Not only have we been using the wells that we drilled then, but we use the wells that the farmers drilled 40 years ago. And we're getting ready to turn those back on here in the next 3 weeks. So I believe it's proof to move forward with design. We've got a strategic plan we're working on. If there is a price tag to this, it's not small per se, but should be considered part of the strategic plan. So, but part of this is to get moving forward and have the ability to move out and get start getting bids and move forward to work. So this is the outline from last time. What we're talking about here is roughly five wells. We'll show you a map real quick again of where these are. A 4 million gallon steel tank, there's one out there right now. We're going to add another one to that. And all the connecting pipelines that go with that connect to the existing system. Existing system has been designed by AECOM to accommodate these additional wells. We thought ahead, realized that we probably would have wells coming from other areas, so we upsized this pipeline to be able to accommodate. So here's a map, kind of a little busy, but the original plan included 19 wells. That's all those little blue dots you see there. And as you can see, there's a couple of purple X's there that were wells that we attempted to drill, but it wasn't a production problem, had water quality problems, so we had to abandon those. So what we've done is we've essentially drilled and equipped 9 of those first 19, abandoned 2, and we're looking at this first bay, or this project, with all of the wells originally conceived as being able to produce somewhere between 40 and 50. What we realize is the north wells have much better production than the ones in the south. So what we're looking at is utilize this property we just recently purchased and then a couple of easements to locate these wells. Question last time came was, we're looking at drilling a couple of these on easements that we got from Solar Star. You'll note the first, there's one up here at the top, right near Avenue A, and then one out here. They're both on easements. I went back, looked at the documents, and we are allowed to not only drill and operate, or drill and equip a well and pipeline, but also have the ability to operate, maintain it. So that was a concern the board had last time.
So are we going to talk to them about that, or you're just going off the documents?
Going off the documents.
Before we go forward, should we have some conversations with
them? It'd probably be a good idea to remind them that we're going to be out there before.
Maybe tell them what we do.
Probably be a good idea to remind them. I believe in the far west, I have to look, that they are not doing anything actively in that parcel or in that area. But where E22 is up there, they have put in solar field. So we may have some impact on the fence line, that kind of thing. So. So yeah, I think definitely making contact with the parking lot at some point. Moving on, this is the revised cost estimate, including 10% contingency, engineering, CEQA, everything, about $12.7 million overall for the 5 months. And put this in, it's not in your packet, you probably have the rest of the slide in your packet. This is the, kind of shows the design schedule, design and construction schedule. And we'd be looking at getting these wells online sometime toward the end of next summer, which would be useful. And then, of course, we have them from then on. The one thing you probably note here is, Dr. Ferguson being the ambitious person that he is, we would be out with bids to well drillers within about 3 weeks. And one of the things that's good about that is, of course, being in short supply, crews to drill wells are in short supply. You get out in front of where you're going to drill and make sure that the spots that you've got are actually going to work. And we found that, even the very beginning project, we had some wells that did work out.
So we're looking at the fall of 16, where are you going?
Yeah, toward the end of summer.
And then, but right now, in absence of initial recharge, the capacity to the pump and far off, they're not awesome. Exceed where warm is.
But do will we have the I think you're asking, do we have the demands to utilize this well? The supply in the ground? Yeah. Well, absolutely. Yes. Oh, absolutely. We need the full, as the plan was completely conceived of, with 19 wells.
Yeah,
we do need, we may not end up with 19. We'll see what these wells bring.
But again, the plan is a living document. In order to meet this chart that was just given to us by the general manager, do we need to have larger green lines in order to meet our demands this year?
This
won't
year?
Won't be available this year.
Won't be available.
Long.
Well, that's it, but I mean,
okay. One of the other things we worked on was the fee. That was a concern last time. We originally had looked at doing 5 separate bidding contracts. This actually says 3 up here. Actually, we're looking at doing 4. We had lumped the tank into one of the contracts, and we decided that was probably not prudent. So we're going to bid the tank separately. Tank constructors are kind of special folks. They work very well on their own. They don't work so well on the floor. So we've been able to drive the cost down just a bit from $49 to $455 as far as the design. We also took some meetings out, normal type design meetings we have here that we could condense that down with that. So that's what we're looking at, $455, so it's time for design and bid assistance.
Mike? Going back to what Neil said, how much more water will it give us? Just say the next year we don't get any water. They shut the aqueduct down, basically. How much additional water would it then give us if we don't get allocation from the state?
This would give us 700 acres.
What does that mean? I mean, what does that mean for how high?
It'd be about 8 MGD. So
okay,
it'd be
8,000. Okay.
Additional for 5 million.
On top of what we're pumping right now. And so, here's the thing we got to kind of look at too is that this is like an insurance policy. I mean, too, on top of just normal, wear and tear. If we don't go ahead and drill these wells, God forbid we don't get any snow or any snowpack. Same exact repeat we had this year. The reason I ask is, why in the heck did you pump to get us next for 8 to 10,000 acre feet of water? I mean, that's going to be a catch. Where do we go from there? I mean, that's something I just want to bring up. If this is, the information
plan has borrowing in, then it's part of the borrowing scheme. Otherwise, we cannot.
So it's something we still have to decide.
How will we fund it? Yeah.
Okay, but for director, she's a board director. One of the places we have money is that 25 million that's making no money for us in, what's it called?
PFM.
PFM, that's an option. There's money there. Just sitting there. So that's our money, but we don't need any more money.
We did do an $8 million exchange.
Oh, that's right.
That's
one more of those and it's probably.
Is it going to be 10 million by the time it's over?
It'll likely be above 10 million.
As long as we don't spend it over and over again.
I will say what I've learned, and I'm relatively new to the well operating wells, is it's great to have well, you know, water in the ground, but well capacity is really where that, if you can pump, that's what they would.
What, the survey, what needs to be done?
What they'll go out there and they'll do survey of the locations, you know, get exact locations so they can work through the designs, and also that'll help with the CEQA to find the areas that are important.
I know you don't know the exact number, but I assume we're going to be drilling more wells in the next 5 years.
You might. Yeah, you go back to the map and conceivably, you know, we could do another 5, you know, later on. We're looking to try to get to about 40 MGD. That's what the design is for the particular facility. If we get 50, that's great. I think much past 50 is going to be a little difficult for this particular problem.
Well, the well replacement, that isn't done by survey, that comes by who chooses those locations.
I mean, choose by an engineer.
Based upon,
usually it's modeling that they do that with. They've already got a pretty good model of the area out there, and they'll test it for certain pumping rates and figure out, you know, how far apart they need to
be. Basically, you're not going to go just X number of feet apart right there around them.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you look at these two wells here, it is kind of X number of feet. Because we bought two parcels here. But they've plugged these into the model to show whether there'll be interference and what the expected capacity. We get more capacity.
Usually, like in the farming communities, we're going to do a water basin, we'll go X number of feet, 660 feet, with one well and the next well.
Gotcha.
I'm not sure what the spacing is, but it looks like it's a predetermined.
Yeah, I think we're looking at, most of the wells are somewhere between 13 and 1700 feet apart.
So, we're not going to use the well. Yeah, I was going to say, George. Well, George, what about him? Water butcher.
Yeah. I wouldn't do something to it.
The bank has never had a problem with pumping that. It's been water quality that we usually have to mitigate the pump.
I think we need wells. I think we're going to need wells in the future. But is this where we need the wells? Or do we need them on the east side? Or do we need them somewhere else? I don't know, and so I can't agree to $455,000 and not say I'm agreeing to $12.7 million.
Well, Neil, unfortunately, our extraction capacity in the West Side Water Bank is far less than our.
I agree with that. I think this board should make a motion of not to exceed $15 million right now. To say that's what it's going to cost to put it out. We always do things piecemeal, and we never get to saying we're setting aside in our budget $15 million to put those wells in, because we do it piecemeal.
So you want to make that motion?
I'm not going to make that motion.
I'll rescind my motion.
I don't know where it's going to come from that, but that's what we do on this. Our motion for this building shouldn't have been for design. It should have been for $5 million to build it and stay within that budget. Or at least have a budget item that says the building, the water bank, that's what the strategic plan is, that's what the capital outlay plan is. But we keep doing 450 here, the next meeting we do $1.2 million, the next meeting we do $3.5 million, the next meeting we're construction management at 450, we're arguing over it. And by the time we're all finished, we've spent $15 million piecemeal, and we never looked at the big picture.
Well, we are looking.
No, we're only approving the $455,000 from the.
But we did look at it. That's why I asked the question about where the money.
Are we going to say, oh, it's too expensive, we don't have the money now, and throw the $455,000 away? Or you're going to say, well, we already spent $455,000, we need to keep it away?
Well, Neil, think of this. We got somewhere between $10 and $12 million right here that we never would have had if we didn't sell that water. I mean, that money's right there to pay what this says right here. I agree with you.
I believe that money should be used to put water in our water banks. Our taxpayers didn't pay any water to put water in the water bank. Are we going to spend it 3 or 4 times? Is it going here? And we now said that money's gone? We've never done that before either.
Well, we could.
So all I'm going to say is I'm going to vote no on this because I think we should be approving an entire project, not a piece of a project at a time. And that's my comment.
Any more comments? All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Opposed.
Thank you.
Okay. Get into the answer. I'm not
know not all of the mutuals were on the governor's list for the water conservation. I don't know, is he going to somewhere along the line hit the mutuals because they're purveyors, or is that any ideas? I mean,
I thought there was a populated like a 3,000 or larger, but I don't know if he's going to shape as it.
I can feel that. We have a couple of districts that aren't on that list. Either it's because they're less than 3,000, they don't qualify as an urban supplier.
So anybody like his farms doesn't have to do the conservation.
No, but the state guidelines says that if you're a small water system, you're required to reduce by 25%.
Okay. And then, so the question, do they have to report?
One time over the reporting period.
Okay, over the reporting period. Do we fall into that because we have a very few kind of falls into a retail customer?
You're looking at me, but I'm looking at Mike, because he sent us a memo that said right now we are not on, you know, that they had a hit list, we're not on the list, but we shouldn't be thinking that we're going to dodge the bullet.
Because, I mean, we do have a few customers that are retail. Are we sending them a notice of saying we're running by
25%?
Yeah, but a couple of them are using it more retail than ag.
Our contract.
But does ag, well, right now ag is not cut at all because the governor is not pressed ag.
There's the 25% goal.
He said,
this is the vision. And he said, water board, you put some implementation together. And that's where that list came up with. And that list had, I believe, urban users on it.
Yeah, all he's done is the urban. So he's not hit any cut in ag right now.
And these customers use less than what the meter typically measures. So we charge half an acre foot a month. How you would quantify their cut would be nearly impossible.
I just wonder when we were going to get into it.
We have one ag customer down there using any kind of quantity of water. It's still very small.
Yes, Rob.
Yeah, have we looked at who's going to cut back as far as our customers, and what percentage, and how that's going to impact the water demands from our agency?
Yeah, the chart that you've got there shows one scenario where there could be some cuts. We're looking at maybe a 10 to 15% cut. We know who's on the list. We saw it was published already. We know who's on the list. The good news, at least from our perspective, you look at 2013 to 2014 usage, most of them are above 25%. One case, RCSD, they essentially went from using about 1,100 acre feet a year to 25. So, really the only customer that we have of any real kind of quantity and could really affect overall either how much we have to give them or not give them is accounting.
So, do you guys know how much you have to cut back at this point?
And now the guidelines say 35%.
For Waterworks for you or for
Waterworks for you?
And so how is that going to impact your requests for water from ABAC or will it?
We haven't figured that out yet. We'll talk with Michael about that.
And how soon can that be?
I think we have an ops meeting next week, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll figure that out next week.
Just a comment for those of you watching, I've been trying to understand. I don't know if you can understand. All the governor has done is taken water use of District 40 divided by the population to come up for the number of gallons per person. So manufacturing, golf courses are all included. So your share of the 160 gallons that he's saying is their target is watering the golf course or whatever. That's what the memo I got.
No, they're looking at just residential. They're using a formula. What your percent residential use was compared to your total use in 2013, that same percentage to your total supply in 2015. So it does only reflect residential use.
What I got just showed population divided by use of that program.
It's population divided, I mean it's use of the theoretical residential sector divided by population.